years ago, I was approached by a CEO who was responsible for the HR functionality within his financial organization. And they had measured an 8% pay gap. So they were going to be very mindful of it in all of their decision making, whether it was hiring, promotions, salary adjustments, etc. However, when they measured again a year later, the gap was still 8%. So it became very clear that you don't fight the gender pay gap with good intentions alone. So when the same CEO asked around, okay, how do I fix this problem? Who should get the first raise? How big should that raise be? Nobody could answer that question. So pay analytics was really born out of the lack of quantitative tools for HR managers tasked with identifying and fixing demographic pay gaps. So we have built a solution. It's a cloud solution that paints a picture of the pay structure of the company. It measures the gender pay gap and provides suggestions on who should get raises and how large should those raises be in order to close the pay gap. And taking into account the operational constraints of the company and the salary structure of the organization. And we are seeing results. So for example, our first development partner drove their gap down to 0% in 2 years using our tool. And we make sure to make it very easy for managers to be able to plan for the investment needed in order to close the gap. So let's say you measure at 4%. We can tell you exactly, okay, how much is it going to cost you to get to 3, to get to 2, 1, and 0. And by using our data-driven approach, we typically save companies between 10 and 30% compared to the naive approach of just extending the same percent raise to every single female employee. So how do we do this? So the methodology behind measuring the pay gap is well known and agreed upon. It's a log regression model. We take all the factors that should explain pay, whether that's job role, education, performance, and gender, and we regress them on wages. The outcome of that model is then the difference in pay after accounting for all the factors. So it's the difference in pay between the genders after we have accounted for the job role and the performance and all the other factors that matter. So our research and development really focused on tearing apart the linear regression behind the measurement and understanding in detail each employee's impact on the gender pay gap. And the results were actually sometimes very counterintuitive. For example, within a workforce, we can find female employees who are such in their characteristics that if I give them a raise, I might actually increase the measured gender pay gap. And similarly, within an organization, I can find men, I give them a raise, and I might actually reduce the gender pay gap. And another really important finding is that the impact of a raise on the gender pay gap has almost zero correlation with the perceived fairness of that raise. So we spend a lot of time during our development with our development partners fine-tuning our optimization approach so that the suggestions that we are providing are both implementable, that they are fair, and they are efficient. Because at the end of the day, the gender pay gap is not just as simple of a problem as somebody wants to keep the wage bill down. In fact, by using our data-driven methods, we can discover where within the pay structure unconscious biases manifest themselves. So just as an example, with one of our clients, we found that top-performing females were not getting compensated to the same extent as top-performing males. So yes, they were, you know, above average, but they weren't being paid to the top like the top-performing males. So the bias is not equally spread over the workforce. And by taking the data-driven approach, it can also allow us to test some of these preconceived notions of what should or is driving pay, experience being one that is typically pointed to. And sometimes the data simply proves us wrong. So in summary, what our solution does, it measures the gender pay gap, so it quantifies the problem. It then allows us to plan on how to fix it, how much is it going to cost us, and it allows us to stay vigilant. Because as much as we want the gender pay gap to be a one-time fix, the fact is if we don't stay on top of the problem, demographic pay gaps will reappear. So what our customers are doing, they're testing every single salary decision before it's being made. So what is the impact on the salary structure, and what is the impact on the gender pay gap? So just like was said in the introduction, pay analytics was born in Iceland, and we have seen an exponential growth over the last few quarters. We now serve 8% of the workforce of Iceland, and we just acquired our first international development partner. If there's somebody interested in the room, I would be happy to chat. And so we are in the position to enter other markets, and we see a lot of market drivers. So the fast-changing regulatory environment is one. So just as an example, in France, in 2 years' time, companies will start facing financial penalties if they're not taking concrete steps to eliminating their pay gap. We also see a lot of action on the state level in the US with new regulations, for example, in Maryland, Massachusetts, New York, and California. But beyond just legal compliance, we increasingly see that companies are, for example, publicizing their pay gap in their annual reports. That creates internal pressure to do better year over year. There we can help. We all know that equitable pay practices can help boost employee morale. It can also give companies an edge in competitive labor markets. And tools such as ours can help companies save money, but it can also save the time of the HR analysts that are tasked with dealing with and eliminating pay gaps. So this is the team behind Pay Analytics. It's myself, David, Gardar, and Sigurjón. I thank you for your attention, and I look forward to the conference and the conversations. Thank you.